So, to begin with, in debunking some of these myths, we undertook a top-down effort to actually look at the structure and power and financial base of the European-centered oligarchical families that 100 years ago vested in the House of Windsor the responsibility for being the primer inter pares, the first among equals, the sort of CEO and chief operations officers of the combined political and financial power of these European houses. And what I'd like to do is actually start with slide number one to go through some of the documentation of this. This is a map of the world which simply indicates in the darkened areas the nations of the British Commonwealth. There are all told 50 member countries in the British Commonwealth, and through various means and subterfuges, the House of Windsor, Queen Elizabeth II, Prince Philip, and the apparatus that surrounds that are in effect the de facto sovereigns over this entire territory. It's a mistake to think of Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip as simply being the sovereigns over this small little shipwrecked entity out here in the edge of the Atlantic called the British Isles. Among the 50 countries of the British Commonwealth, Queen Elizabeth II is the formal sovereign in 17 of those countries. And while these are not in many cases the largest of the nations, if one looks at the importance of the offshore financial centers, such as the British sovereign islands in the Caribbean, Hong Kong, and similar locations, one begins to see that within the realm of the international illegal black market and drug apparatus, this is an absolutely indispensable part of the capability. Let's now switch over to the first table. Webster Tarpley mentioned earlier that Queen Elizabeth II of Great Britain is a descendant of the House of Windsor, which took the name Windsor in the early years of the 20th century, but which has been on the sovereign throne of England since the beginning of the 18th century. However, to begin to actually understand what we're talking about here, it's important to actually take in, at least briefly, and I would urge people to look this chart over more carefully, it's included in the EIR issue that you all have, to consider the extended family, the cousinhood, if you will, of intermarried royal houses which today maintain the thrones in a number of European countries, Scandinavia, England, Greece, Spain. There are now, in the aftermath of the fall of the Iron Curtain, efforts underway to reestablish monarchical lines of succession on the sovereign thrones of places like the former Yugoslavia, like Russia itself. And so the point is that we're not simply here discussing Great Britain, England, the House of Windsor. We're talking about an interlocking family directorate which maintains claims and real estate titles over many parts of the world and which uses the sovereign authority over dozens of governments around the world as an integral part of their power base. Now, while the combined power and financial assets of this extended royal family tree do not reside in any single formal organization which is registered with some Secretary of State's office, there is nevertheless an informal name which is given to the extended apparatus which Elizabeth and Philip at the present time are the reigning CEO and chief operations officers over. Among some of the people involved in this, the name that's frequently used is the Club of the Isles. We're talking about the British royal household, the Dutch royal household, some of the Scandinavian houses, Greece, Spain, and some of the others. And the actual assets, combined financial power of these royal households and some of their associated princely families has been roughly estimated in present dollar terms, direct control, direct ownership, over one and perhaps pushing $2 trillion. Since much of this combined wealth takes the form of shares in various crown authorized joint stock company ventures modeled on the old British and Dutch East India companies, the actual resources, material resources, at the disposal of this combined apparatus are somewhere in the vicinity, again estimated because of the degree of secrecy involved here, estimated at within the range of approximately $10 trillion in real assets, much of it real estate, much of it ownership through intermediaries over the majority shares in major corporations like Rio Tinto Zinc, Unilever, Royal Dutch Shell, British Petroleum, the Anglo-American Corporation, Imperial Chemical Industry. If you look at the concentration of raw material control exerted by this combine of companies, you begin to get at least a first approximation of the financial and political clout that we're talking about here. And unlike the current American notions of what it means to be a stockholder in a corporation, these companies operate off of the old Venetian party methods, which were reflected in the efforts of the British East India Company in the 18th and 19th centuries, and ownership also constitutes tight political control, such that if one were to look at the events of the last decade or so and contemplate things like the 8-year war between Iran and Iraq, the more recent war against Iraq, some of the wars that have been manipulated throughout the continent of Africa. Through these means, not only has this apparatus exerted geopolitical control and manipulation, overreaching the sovereignty of nation states to exert their control, but in every one of these ventures, they have always made it a point of using the methods of insider trading to profiteer to the maximum extent off of the misery of billions of human beings. This is just a very small segment of what we have called Prince Philip's corporate SS. And as we begin in a moment to discuss the specific role of the World Wildlife Fund, now known as the Worldwide Fund for Nature, you'll see that branched around this institution and branched around the British monarchy are a highly interfaced network of banks, raw material cartels, and other corporate entities that constitute one single concentration of political and financial power. One of the best examples that is worth considering here is if you look under Barclays Bank PLC, Sir Martin Wakefield Jacob, who retired a year or so ago as the chairman, one of the chairmen of Barclays Bank, the same Sir Martin Wakefield Jacob is on the Bank of England, sits on the board of directors of the Rio Tinto Zinc Corporation, which has strong interfaces with Imperial Chemical and a number of these other entities. Jacob is also on the board of the Telegraph PLC, which is one of the Crown's most important propaganda arms, not only owning the Telegraph papers in England, but being part of the Hollinger Corporation, which owns the Jerusalem Post, which owns most of the financial press in the English-speaking world, and owns well over 100 newspapers in the United States alone. So this is, in effect, a part of the integrated propaganda apparatus that goes along with all of these things. the Anglo-American Corporation, De Beers Mining, and De Beers Centenary AG, are companies that Al Douglas will probably say a little bit more about, but suffice it to say that those are, along with Lonro, the principal entities that are the form through which this apparatus exerts its control over the continent of Africa on behalf of a systematic policy of genocide. This is a rough approximation of the military command structure, and the point here is to just convey a certain overall sense of the invisible command structure through which the House of Windsor exerts its political and financial control on behalf of a very specific policy outlook. And I think it's worth looking at this chart from the standpoint of a certain timeline as well. We've already seen that the entity known as the Club of the Isles, this combined interlocking series of royal households and the combined wealth that they exert, has been around for a long period of time. Its formal existence probably dating back 100 years. For a century, the only people who talked about ecology and the concern about nature and about endangered species were people who were immediately and blatantly associated with the British royal household and with similar royal households in other countries of Europe. Entities like the Royal Geographical Society, the Zoological Society of London, were founded well over 100 years ago. Groups like the Fauna and Flora Preservation Society, which formerly was known as the Preservation Society of the Empire, have been around since the turn of the century. At the close of the Second World War, a second phase was opened up, which in part was posed by the problem that the public exposure of the genocide by the Hitler regime during World War II gave the pet pseudoscience of the British royal household, the pseudoscience of eugenics, a bad name, because the practices of World War II demonstrated what the actual motives were of the eugenics movement, the culling of the human herd in order to perpetuate the power of this oligarchy. So at the close of World War II, the same exact people who were involved in perpetrating the fraud, the racial fraud of eugenics, set up a series of new organizations aimed at pursuing the identical policies, but simply under a slightly more benign public relations title, Nature Conservation. So the Nature Conservancy was set up at the end of the Second World War. The International Union for the Conservation of Nature was set up at the same time frame, and you'll see that this was set up on the basis of a constitution that was formally drafted by the British Foreign Office. The United Nations Organization in particular, through UNESCO, which was founded and headed by Julian Huxley, a leading figure founding the IUCN, and one of the people who for decades had been the head of the eugenics movement inside England. So these organizations were set up during the period immediately following the close of World War II to revive the eugenics movement under the name of Nature Conservancy. In the early 1960s, as a cornerstone of Britain's phony decolonization policy, during the period of the Winds of Change, the World Wildlife Fund was founded specifically to be the instrumentality through which the House of Windsor and Great Britain would reassert in even more brutal form its imperial control over parts of the world like Africa. And so the World Wildlife Fund was founded in 1961, and the details of the WWF story in Africa will be told in just a few minutes by Al Douglas. Suffice it to say that the World Wildlife Fund was initially founded by two men, Prince Philip, the royal consort of Queen Elizabeth II, and Prince Bernhard, the royal consort of the Queen of the Netherlands. Now, whereas Prince Philip thinks like a Nazi, Prince Bernhard had the honor, quote unquote, of having had the formal credentials of being a leading figure within the Nazi Party. He was recruited to the Nazi Party as a young student at the University of Berlin in the early 1930s, was assigned to a critical intelligence responsibility as the intelligence officer assigned to the IG Farben chemical cartel, which produced the gas that was used in the Nazi gas chambers. Parenthetically, throughout the Second World War, the alliance between IG Farben and the imperial chemical industry of England was never broken. And so we have Prince Philip and Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands jointly founding the WWF and running that organization to this day as one of the important uniformed divisions of the overall Prince Philip's Allgemeine SS. Now, in the late 1960s, it was still the case that the vast majority of people who favored radical environmentalism and some of these other causes that today we come to think of as having a certain mass base of support were nevertheless simply oligarchs, plain and simple. By the late 1960s, through the advent of the drug, rock, sex counterculture, which was, if nothing else, an assault on reason, an attack on any kind of semblance of science. By the late 1960s, suddenly there was a large number of people who, in between drug stupors, were susceptible to some of the quack science of this oligarchical apparatus. And as a result of that, we find in the late 1960s the founding of organizations like Greenpeace, Friends of the Earth, Survival International, which advocated in the most ruthless terms a return to primitivism, in effect the creation of human zoos in many different parts of the planet. And in turn, in the late 1970s, as it became somewhat of an embarrassment that every one of these organizations had been publicly and knowingly funded directly from the inner circles of Prince Philip through the WWF and the 1001 Club, which I'll get into in a minute, suddenly these groups themselves began spinning off even more violent eco-terrorist organizations, which operate with abandon in many parts of the world today. And this is another element of the capability that is tightly deployed top-down through this structure that we're talking about here. This is a profile of the operations of the World Wildlife Fund. This is the kind of map that one can envision in the headquarters of the World Wildlife Fund and IUCN in Gland, Switzerland. You see that much of Africa, much of South America, almost the entirety of North America, all of Europe, and significant parts of Asia are areas that have been identified as prime targets of the WWF, either as locations where they have formal national organizations or areas where they have established operational bases. Particularly, we'll see the extensive activities in Eastern Africa. This is just a brief profile of some of the things that you saw on the previous map. The kinds of people who presently sit on the International Advisory Council, the number of countries that now have either formal affiliation with the WWF or have program offices. Next. Now, in 1971, Prince Philip and Prince Bernhard decided that it was necessary to upgrade the financial foundations of the WWF, and working off of Prince Bernhard's Rolodex, a group of several thousand people were contacted and invited to become founding chartered members of an entity called the 1001 Club, which was specifically called a nature trust. And these were people who were in many instances fabulously wealthy, but were chosen principally because of their allegiance and affiliation to the outlook of Prince Philip and Prince Bernhard. And these are just, by breakdown of countries, an indication of where the 1001 Club membership is based. Among the kinds of people that we saw in the membership ranks of the club were people who typified during the World War II period membership in the Allgemeine SS. You've got virtually every living member of the Rothschild family. You have representatives of the major international British and Dutch oil companies, all of the major City of London banks, the members of every princely family of Europe, a handful, a small scattering of African leaders, government officials who have been, in effect, recruited and co-opted into this apparatus. But interestingly, among the membership in the 1001 Club, a number of other kinds of people stand out because their international reputations today are those of international rogues, gangsters, and killers. For example, Robert Vesco, who's now a fugitive from justice in the United States, was a recently indicted member of the Medellin cocaine cartel, was one of the founding members by invitation of the 1001 Club. Similarly, Tibor Rosenbaum, who was one of the principal money launderers for the Meyer-Lansky International Crime Syndicate in Switzerland, was also a principal figure within the 1001 Club and one of the early invited members. The Cisneros family in Venezuela, which has been recently exposed for its involvement and association with people in the international drug money laundering business and other crimes, also show up on the list. So it's a unsavory as well as well-connected group of people. And this, in a certain sense, is a part of the organized directorate over this entire international genocidal eugenics nature conservation movement today. Now, I just want to finish up by making one final observation, because, in effect, what we attempted to pull together in this initial EIR study was, as Webster Tarpley indicated at the beginning, a literal bill of indictment, a criminal bill of indictment. If one can envision a reconvening of the Nuremberg tribunals that took place at the end of World War II, the people who we identify in this report would all be in the docket for crimes against humanity that make the crimes of the Nazi regime of World War II seem small in comparison. What's more, Prince Philip has made it a point repeatedly of flaunting his commitment to genocide and has written books, articles, has given interviews with major international news organizations in which he has made his views about the importance of culling the human species increasingly more and more well known. The concept for the present day that has been adopted by Prince Philip, by the WWF apparatus, for quote unquote saving the oligarchical system at this moment of profound breakdown crisis, is to carry out genocide against practically 80% of the world's population. The objective of the WWF and the Club of the Isles and this apparatus that we're talking about here is to reduce the population of the world to below 1 billion people over the next 2 to 3 generations, which means a level of population genocide on a global scale that even surpasses the genocide in Africa in recent years. Prince Philip is unabashed about this, and as he told reporters for the German news agency DPA in a published interview in August 1988, quote, "In the event that I am reincarnated," and I can assure you that he believes in reincarnation, "I would like to return as a deadly virus in order to contribute something to solve overpopulation." Now, one might speculate that this was an offhand comment made perhaps under a drug or alcohol stupor or a moment of particular rage or sexual frustration, but indeed, repeatedly in recent years, Prince Philip has repeated this identical formulation. In one instance, in the foreword to a book that he wrote, in which he had ample opportunity to do final editing and rethink the words that were going to be attributed to him. In the foreword to his 1986 autobiographical confessions called If I Were an Animal, Prince Philip said, and I quote, "I just wonder what it would be like to be reincarnated in an animal whose species had been so reduced in numbers that it was in danger of extinction. What would be its feelings towards the human species whose population explosion had denied it somewhere to exist? I must confess that I am tempted to ask for reincarnation as a particularly deadly virus." Now, the image of culling the human herd has been something that's been on Philip's mind for a long time. In another one of his published works called Down to Earth, published in 1988, he said, quote, "I don't claim to have any special interest in natural history, but as a boy, I was made aware of the annual fluctuations in the number of game animals and the need to adjust the cull to the size of the surplus population." Prince Philip's concept is to apply the same methods, the culling through genocide of the entire surplus population of human beings, and we will now hear from Al Douglas to get some sort of an idea of one of the most graphic and ongoing aspects of implementation of the Prince Philip and WWF design. Thank you.